be ashamed.
This is a dual appreciation.
Isn't it, though? This is absolutely... I got to thank you first for suggesting to do a show like this, because I don't know about you, but in my life, there are certain subjects, especially if you're into a technical field or you're an artist or you're into something that's dense, and music certainly fits that. If you're into something like that, the people who might also appreciate that musical form can be somewhat limiting sometimes. And so when you find somebody like Frank, who's very idiosyncratic and extremely what he is, a lot of other people's eyes kind of go, kind of glaze over, and their head kind of separates from their neck, and it's on a little balloon string, and it goes upstairs, and they, This gentleman was the one of the greatest composers of the 20th century, and I don't think you can talk about him enough.
Oh, yeah. Just like Jimbo couldn't talk enough about Wickenseed. You couldn't stop. I mean, there's just so much of it, and it's so rich. And being able, as I get older, to appreciate more and more of it, it is just a wonder. It's a gift that keeps on giving.
Yeah.
And he was just... this world could use another Frank. It's a shame that he had to go when he went, because especially the last few years, everybody could have used a little Frank Zappa.
Yeah. As a matter of fact, I think it would have been fascinating to see his take on the recent, certainly the recent political scene, because he was already doing that back in 88 and 68 and 78 and kind of pulling the wool right off, you know.
Oh, yeah.
Their eyes.
More trouble coming every day, right on down the line.
Yeah. Always.
You are
always
what you is.
I'm
surprised they haven't come and canceled him for things like "You Are What You Is."
Yeah. It is funny. I guess it's just because he's become such an iconic figure. Many know the man's name and have no idea what he did. None whatsoever. And it's, or they have this impression of him, some wild guy who, you know, bites the heads off chickens on stage or does something bizarre. And it's so weird because he never did anything. Oh, he did weird things on stage.
Oh, he did.
But never like that.
You know? No, and he was one of the bands in that time. I mean, everybody else, Flower Power and doing all these, you know, recreational substances.
Yes.
And about as much as he got into recreational substances, from what I can see, was the beer at the end of everything.
That's exactly right. As a matter of fact, let me play this.
Okay.
This is Frank Zappa from the Mothers of Invention.
Hi, wanna die? Start today. Use a little speed. You got 5 years. Rot your mind, rot your heart, rot your kidneys, cucaracha.
A public service announcement of the Do It Now Foundation.
Now, do you remember that spot? Because I do. And this was late 60s, early 70s. And I thought I guess everybody thought, why is this guy... He's talking, you know, I wasn't a speed user, but I think everybody kind of imagined that anybody that was in that world was going to be deep into that, you know, stuff.
And he also said speed will turn you into your parents.
That's right. That's another one of those same spots, same organization. Yes, he did. He knew who he was talking to.
Yeah.
And vehemently against it. And of course, never allowed it in his bands or
That's kind of how we got Little Feet. He threw the potheads out of the band and the druggies and they put together Little Feet.
True. That was 1969. Oh my God. Laurel George. Yeah. Just a great loss there too. But yeah. Just no patience for that kind of stuff. And you know, I mean, you look at the kind of material the guy was recording, the time signature shifts, the multiple genres within one piece of music, you had better be on your A game if you're going to play this kind of stuff.
Well, he caught me. I was probably 6 or 7 years old, and my older cousins had the Freak Out album.
Yeah.
So for me, I didn't know what a time signature was. And it wasn't till much later that I just had these songs in my head, and I didn't ever, until I started playing music and tried to play it, mm-hmm. had any understanding that he wasn't just playing, it's normal time.
Yeah. I think I was 10, and it was 1966, and I came across Freak Out and had no context. Absolutely zero. Think about what was out in 1966. There was no context for that kind of music at all. I mean, everything was
Hendrix wasn't here yet. I mean, it was like surf music.
Right.
Yeah, that was before the summer of it. For all intents and purposes, that was the first psychedelic album.
It really, really was. Certainly the first double album concept album. But you go back and listen to that stuff now, and it's like, there are things. Yes, he got better players to put his work across through his career. But that idea, that continuity that we talk about all the time, that particular thing, that started with the first album all the way to the very last note he ever played. It was definitely one big note, as he used to say. But
and the bio on the album fascinated me as a kid, because it basically said sometimes he shows up, like they had gigs without him, and sometimes Frank would show up, but he had these guys who he taught how to make all this music.
Yeah, in his earlier days, where I think it's probably what he ended up calling Studio Z back when he bought that recording studio from that chat.
Yep.
Yeah, where the guy built, what was it, a 5-track machine? I think that's what it was. He built his own machine so they recorded tons of stuff, not the Mothers, but you know, in his early days, but a lot of stuff on those machines. And apparently, the lovely and talented Joe Travers, who is the vault meister of the Zappa Trust and the keeper of all things on tape back there, he says that the machine still exists.
Oh, wow.
And it's still there. It's, quote, functioning, but you have to play tapes on it, obviously, that were recorded on it, because you can't just take that.
Yeah, no, you can't put a 5-track tape on a 4-track player. Something's not going to.
Because this was the only one in the world. And so the only tapes that are going to work on it are the ones you did on it. But I found that fascinating, because all that early stuff he was great about preserving things.
Yeah,
he really was.
It's amazing. They're still kicking out live shows that. And I'm happy that some of the older ones are turning up, because just the earlier the live show of him, for me, it's like the better.
Yeah, it's great stuff. There's the one that got released last week, actually, called Funky Nothingness.
Mm-hmm.
And it was originally, apparently, according to them, was originally designed to be the follow-up to Hot Rats.
Uh-huh.
But it got cut up and put in other, you know, he did that. It got remangled. There, I have to shout out to these guys too, because if you've not heard them, it's worthy to drop the needle, as we'd say, on these guys. A guy named Scott Parker hosts a program called the Zappa Cast. He's been doing it for years, and it's in concert with the Zappa family thing and all that. So Joe Travers is a frequent guest on there, and a lot of alumni who have come back to visit. Some people that you thought, aren't you dead? No, okay. But they're not. And it's great. And so, but what's great is that Travers will tell you about how he's trying to pull all this stuff, you know, back together from what's indicated on the labels of some of these tapes, because apparently Frank had built this monumental tome that never got released. It got repurposed. Mm. It was something going to be called The Collected Improvisations of the Mothers of Invention. He had envisioned this as a 19-album box set. Just sit on that for a minute. But apparently he repurposed it before he had the chance to even do it. So a lot of these tracks either got eliminated, shortened, or scattered to all these other releases that came out in the ensuing years. But I just thought, wow, what the hell?
It's just that he had a mind like that. I mean, I remember reading years ago that he was coming out with an album called No Commercial Potential.
Right.
That never, but all the songs talked about on it that popped up somewhere in some form or other over the next 15 years. And then he stopped releasing anything for a while. And then Zootalures came out, which was sonically so different than right. anything he'd ever done before.
Yeah.
And then he almost never did another real studio album. He would take live shows that he conducted and sweeten them with a few musicians at a time. But
yeah, it was that period right after what has been called later Leather, that album, which because of the delightful people at Warner Brothers.
him and labels.
they refused his contract. His contract specified that he had 4 more albums to do to be done with them.
Right.
So he did them.
Yep.
All at once, and gave them the option to release it that way. And they said, nah, I can't. So he went down to the local radio station and he put it on the air so everybody could hear it, because they weren't going to release it the way he had intended. And that was the end of that, and a big lawsuit and all that. And he eventually got free, of course. But yeah, then he started his own label, which is that was the smart move to do. And then you hire someone like Capitol to do your distribution. And that's it.
Yep.
They're just jobbers at that point.
Yeah, but Capitol, I mean, they did well with the Beatles. Added reverb, and well, they had their reasons for changing, you know, as far as royalties and all that. And any business person at the time probably would have done the same thing.
Yeah.
It's just awkward, especially now, because most people know the Beatles albums as completely different entities than is like hammered into my brain from growing up with them.
Yeah, I know. You know, and when we were first talking about this, I know it seems that seems like this is the most daunting idea ever, but it would kind of would be fun to at some point just take a little bite-sized piece of maybe the initial canon of his.
Yeah,
of his
work. I would be game for going the distance with those, because I got Spotify recently. I used to have the albums all over the place, and Spotify has everything. Right. When Spotify started, I was like, this is stupid. They'd have like a re-recorded version instead of the original of a lot of songs. And I dismissed it for about 3-4 years. And recently I got a password. And now it's like I have to have my own membership for what they're charging. It makes Apple Music seem like a joke. Almost everybody is on there. There are very few people who don't have everything on there, including you know, you could buy an extended version of an album. Their extended versions have like a whole other disc somehow of stuff that wasn't on the commercial release.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's worthy of it. I mean, it's almost worthy just for him, but they were doing, they might still be. You remember Live 365?
Oh, yeah. I still run a station that's on it for the local youth group.
Well, there you
radio.
Go.
It's the most horrible interface on earth. But
yeah,
I volunteer and do the dupe.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's good. I mean, it's still doing its thing. Back in like 2001 or 2 or 3 or early 2000s. I know it was early 2000s. When Zappa launched their website.
Yep.
They had a radio button. And they still do, but it doesn't go to them. It goes somewhere else. But you could just push that button, and you could listen to It'd be weeks before you heard anything twice.
Oh,
I mean, the catalog is ridiculous and growing posthumously here as well.
No, only like Willie Nelson has a bigger catalog than Frank Zappa. Willie Nelson, it's amazing how many albums somehow he came out with.
Yeah, yeah, they're prolific people. Well, of course, Willie's been going. He's been going a long time.
Since the late 50s, I guess.
Yeah, yeah, he's been going a while. But, you know, if Frank had been active then, he'd probably give him a run for his money.
Oh, yeah. And covered a much wider, I mean, I don't think there's a genre he didn't, well, he didn't do a hip-hop song that I can think of, but.
No, not hip-hop, but he did do something called Promiscuous.
The Surgeon General, Dr. Coop, is supposed to give you all the poop. But when he's with PMRC, the poop he's scooping amazes me. C-SPAN showed him all dressed up in his phony Dr. God, get up. He looked in the camera and fixed his specs. He gave a fascinating lecture about anal sex. Anal sex.
So when was the first time you saw him?
I only got to see him live once. On the last tour at Poughkeepsie Mid-Hudson Civic Center.
Oh, wow.
And unfortunately, they were controlling, you had to sit, and it was all folding chairs on the floor. And there was a psychopath sitting in front of me that even security was afraid of. And the man did not stop shouting and standing in front of me for the entire show. And I did enjoy the show, but that really took the edge off of it.
Oh, man. Well, you're very lucky because you saw the 88 band then.
Oh, that was just so tight.
That's one of the greatest, you know, it's funny. It took him his whole life, but two things happened. First, he got that band together, which by far was
the greatest band you never heard.
That's right. That's right. And also he, yes, but, and also he got to work with Ensemble Moderne from the Czech Republic. And those guys they're brilliant. To this day, they're still releasing material, his material, in context with some of their other work. And it's wonderful. I mean, the stories he'd used to tell about working with the LSO and other symphonies and so forth, being what he said was basically worse than working in rock and roll band, because the egos were even more inflated and more ridiculous. And then he meets these people who are, they're at rehearsal 2.5 hours before he gets there to start rehearsal, because they are that much committed to it. And then when you turn around and you hear them play synclavier music in acoustic formats. This was never intended to be played by a human being. Written for a machine, and they do it, and it's impeccable. It's like, oh my God,
I don't know. Yeah, he would have played with them, but I wonder whether he ever would have tried to play, especially with the technology now.
Mm-hmm.
It's just no reason to fight with egos and people.
Oh, yeah. Oh, absolutely. The only reason to do it would have been for the performance aspect. You know, as he got sicker, obviously, that wasn't going to happen. He made some great attempts, for sure. But, I was very blessed to have seen him many times. Never saw the 88 band because they never made it to where I was living.
Did you ever get close enough to see what he was using as a pick? Because there's the footage of him on the Mike Douglas show. And I'd swear he's using a John Kennedy half dollar for his guitar pick.
I have seen him do that with metal. I have seen him do that. Yeah,
Now that's a hard pick.
In fact, that was a thing. That's a that was a thing for a while. Actually, people were doing that. You know, you can buy them now. You can. I'm really happy to say that a show that I had attended in 1984, at the it's no longer there. It's the Bayfront Center in St. Petersburg, Florida. That performance of A Ship Too Late to Save a Drowning Witch and The Green Hotel is on You Can't Do That on Stage Anymore, Volume 3. So listening to that again, knowing that you're sitting in the audience, and that is the weirdest existential echo I think I've ever experienced. It's just, yeah, I'm sitting in that audience.
And it's just the number of musicians that pass through that band over 25 years is just...
Yeah, it's astounding. And so many of them were either emerging, you know, and then after that experience went on to do incredible work with, you know, other people. Not like working with Frank, but certainly incredible. The guy that comes to mind immediately is Adrian Belew. His work with Zappa and also King Crimson.
Yeah.
Just, there's a guy who lives for this.
He just did something with Les Claypool, I think.
Yes. Did you see that too?
Yeah, that was... Although the people, some of them just disappeared, like George Duke.
Yeah, they although they stayed friends, from what I understand, there were always connections there. But yeah, George kind of had, he wanted to do that jazz thing, you know, and on this release I just picked up, there's a demo that Frank produced for George that's included as four separate tracks. And it's called Waka Wazoo.
Ooh.
So it's all those sessions. And then as one of the mystery discs, there are four or five tracks by George Duke. And Frank produced them. You can hear it. But you can hear where George wanted to go. You certainly could.
Yeah, he was more of a straight jazz guy at heart.
Yeah.
And Zappa produced the last official Grand Funk Railroad album.
Yes, he did. Which, from what I understand, Mark Farner still to this day says, "Wow, man, best record we ever did."
Yeah, well, it may well have been. I mean, they didn't have any hits.
Yeah,
but
I probably was closer to what they were all about, you know, because that would certainly
And he
be...
rescued the Turtles when their management went sour.
Yeah, that's right. And who knew? I don't know what you were thinking, but when I heard that, I thought they were joking. I thought it was like, Zappa?
What?
Okay, how's this going to work? Oh, it worked really well. Worked really well. Some of the most bizarre music to come out of that period.
And the live shows, I mean, every one of them I've heard is just, it's not like hearing some band on tour and it's the same show over and over.
Oh, no. And 200 Motels, you know, which was coming out during that whole period of time. I'm so glad that this older stuff is, and some stuff we've never heard, is starting to come out. I can see in some of these releases, as much as I appreciate them, why he probably would not have elected to do that. I think his, if you look at that You Can't Do That on Stage Anymore collection, that all those discs, there are very specific tracks he has in there, and there are very specific performances. And I have a copy of, it's called The Last Show? The Last U.S. Performance, Zappa 88.
Uh-huh.
And though there's some great stuff there, they're not as great as the one he put together, though. The energy in that show, because it was from all over the world, it wasn't just from the U.S., but the energy in there and the interplay and the laughing and the fun that these people are having on stage was, in spite of what was going on allegedly backstage where things were falling apart and everything, is just a delight to hear. I don't know how many times I've played it, but it's just a delight.
And just that he could do these long form things like Billy the Mountain. And yes, the one he put on the album is probably the best overall of all of them. But there's so many parts that didn't get included in that are remarkable.
Oh my God. Yeah. Oh, my God. And, you know, that would be the other thing. They'd do something like King Kong, for instance, which is this voluminous epic. And they'd change it. They would every you know, like, and I think Ian Underwood, who was a keyboard player and horn player for them for a while.
Yeah.
He said that, you know, every show there'd be some tweak. And you'd have to understand, these guys would have to memorize how many hours of material, you know, because every night they would call up something and Frank would have an idea, you know, and we're going to do a little adjustment to this.
And it, yeah, he was able to just, well, once he got good enough musicians, or well, I think Ian Underwood was the first one that he could communicate with on a higher
on
musical level. Because, you know, the Mothers were, he pushed them as far
as they could go.
A bar band.
That's right.
Could possibly go in a little farther. But yeah, you could, they just one by one dropped off and said, look, we love you, Frank, but we can't do this.
It's so true. It's so true. I mean, and you got to hear it. You hear it from the early days where he wanted to take that stuff. And, you know, you're absolutely right, too, about Zoot Allures. That was a real shock. And I you read some of the history about that album. And first of all, it was a quartet, really.
Yep.
Right.
It's smallest band he ever worked with.
Absolutely. And very in your face.
Oh, yeah.
And also produced some of the most anthemic tracks that he's done. Black Napkins. And
oh, yeah. Just wind up working in a gas station.
But my favorite, and it scared the hell out of me the first time I heard it on that album. It really, really did. There was something about that extra voice part. The Torture Never Stops, which is an amazing piece of work. Every time I hear it, I, you know, it's just, it is one of my, it's just one of my. But the first time I heard it, that young lady who was undergoing further entertainment.
Yeah.
It's like, what is happening here?
Yeah.
And there was a guy out here who was Frank's copyist for years. And he said that he was working with Frank around that time to translate a lot of the stuff into notation. And he came to Frank's house one day to further his work and heard that those outtakes, I guess it was, of a her performance, and asked, what's going on here? And Frank just told him, he's like, oh, it's just a little entertainment. It's just a little,
entertainment. And that song is, I mean, it's how many chords? You could do it live really easily.
Yes.
And did he? I don't think that.
Yeah, there are live versions of that. Yeah, there are live versions of it.
Flies all green and buzzing in the dungeon of despair. Prisoners grumble and kiss their clothes and scratch their matted hair. A tiny little light from a window hole 100 yards.
And for years, I just had a direct preference for his studio albums, not his live albums.
Yeah.
And aside from Roxy and Elsewhere.
Oh, God, that's so good.
Which just so good. That when I finally got my hands on it, I was just a kid when these were coming out. So I had to save up money. And then I was in Monticello, New York. So I had to special order these records. And some of the one record store would not, he refused to special order Frank Zappa.
What? Wow.
Well, that was, maybe it was the devil's music or something.
I guess. Wow.
I remember going in there wanting to order burnt weenie sandwich, and he just looked me in the face like I was asking him to order, you know, whip me, fuck me, kill me, suck me.
That wasn't on any of Frank's albums, just saying. But yes, absolutely.
But I eventually got my hands on all of it. One way or another, in the summers, it's a summer resort town. And a lot of my Zappa growth came from these guys who ran a t-shirt shop called the International Bippy Shop. And this must have been 1972, 73.
Oh, yeah. Now you're in it.
And yeah, they would order the records for me. And I think all the extra money I made working in an arcade that summer
went to that.
Yep.
Well, we do what we have to do, don't we?
Oh, yeah. For Zappa.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. It's, and, you know, I guess it's kind of hard for people on the outside. I mean, a lot of folks have great affection for musical artists and so forth. And I
certainly understand Frank that. Just can't get on the Zappa bandwagon. And he's tried sincerely a few times. And mm-hmm. it's just, there's something about it that.
I guess it is. There is music out there that truly is an acquired taste. There truly is. I don't know that Frank is that way. I think you have to start. I always point people to one size fits all.
That's the one.
Because look, this is going to be the safest entry for you. And then you can go explore. You can go back in the catalog and go forward and have a happy day, because it will be very different and wonderful for you. But that album is usually the easiest accessible endpoint. Yep. And funny and wonderful and just.
Oh, you know, yeah. And the time check. Andy. Oh, yeah.
Florentine Pogan.
She was the daughter of a wealthy Florentine Pogan. She was a debutante, Daisy with a color note. Oh yeah. Deep in the street, she drove a 59.
You know, I had to do some research to actually find out what the hell he was talking. He'd never said. Found out it's a cookie.
A Florentine Pogan is a I didn't know that either.
A cookie with a Florentine motif on the top of it.
Ah.
So there you are. So she was the daughter of a cookie.
Oh, man. Yeah, and his material like that, it just keeps giving 50 years later.
Yeah, it's more joy. There's more joy. But so I get it that some people have a hard time with that. But I think sometimes it's just they come into it. Somebody drops something like lumpy gravy on their lap. Okay, that might take a little understanding, because there's a lot going on there. There's an orchestra. There's spoken word parts. There's all sorts of
classical
things.
Music. Still, I have to like take a nice deep breath, because I want that instant gratification to this very day in my music. And no, you really have to let it get in your head.
Yeah, Yellow Shark and stuff like that. It's.
But Francesco Zappa, which that album, you could fool somebody into saying Frank Zappa did an album of Christmas music. Let's listen to it on Christmas. And it works.
Yes, it does. He never got to do, I think he was planning on it, but he never got to do an album of Varese. I know he was wanted to do that, but I've heard those before I was aware of his love of that guy. I had heard a selection called Ionization, and it's only in retrospect that you see where his little, he's not ripping off Varese. There's homages certainly, but there's like, I think there's a tonal understanding.
Yeah, not a kinship just between the way they think about music.
Yeah.
And then you got Johnny Guitar Watson's old single, 3 Hours Past Midnight, which you almost hear Zappa's primal guitar solo style being played in 1958.
Man, I'm so glad those two guys found each other, because he was his vocals on something like Down in France. I smile all the way through that thing. Couldn't get much airplay, but it's one of the funkiest tracks.
the stuff he got airplay out of is just, I don't want to get drafted.
Yes. Yeah.
Which, it's a cute song. I had the single and the whole thing, shot in the foxhole, the whole bit, but.
Exactly.
when people find, oh, this is Frank Zappa. Well, let's listen to some more, Brett. And I put on something and go,
yeah, yeah. Where's that younger, funnier guy?
And his love of doo-wop. I mean, Ruben and the Jets, that album gets better every, and it really, there wouldn't have been a Sha-na-na without Ruben and the Jets. And without Sha-na-na, a good case can be made for the whole rock and roll revival thing that happened in the early 70s.
Absolutely, because, you know, that performance at Woodstock apparently lit everybody on fire. You know, the thing, too, is he was recently credited for this, and I'm glad somebody pointed this out, because all of us jazzers always sort of look at Bitches Brew, as Miles Davis' Bitches Brew, as being sort of that turn where fusion was born. Actually not. It was Hot Rats. It was Hot Rats. He beat Bitches Brew by a few months. So 69, 70, you know, that was the turning point. And you listen to Hot Rats now and you'll hear it. It's all over.
That was the first instrumental Zappa that I really didn't have a tendency to skip over when I had the albums as a kid. I mean, even when I first got it, I would listen to Willie the Pimp and then take it off. But over time, it clicked or something. And, you know, that album is, and there's a lot of Sun Ra influence on that.
There's another name. Yeah, there's another name.
And they had that same mentality, an outsider who demanded a lot out of their musicians and would take somebody who almost couldn't play. And if they were committed enough, would give them the chance and work them. And Sun Ra would just like sit there, fall asleep and wake back up and hope the band had continued playing. Because I don't think the guy ever slept for more than an hour at a time.
I can't imagine. I mean, and you could see his acceleration point. I mean, he was doing pretty straight ahead stuff in the 50s there. And then as it got later in the 50s, then something.
John Gilmore happened, I think.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. Well, then we went to Saturn and it was the Sunlight Orchestra. But we must do this.
Oh, yes.
So. Oh, we have to do the little bit of that, you know, and I'm thinking, with your kind permission, I might pepper a couple of things under what we're talking about.
Oh, yeah. Because I mean, it won't let it be posted on YouTube, probably. Oh, I could. Something got claimed by at the part of one of the last great appreciation showcases. It can't be heard in Russia because of a Kenny G theme song, but only in Russia.
Okay.
And I can never monetize it like I'm going to monetize. Yeah.
Yeah, right. You're going after that for sure. Although I have to say, I have heard. Just this, today, actually, I was on YouTube, and what things will come up will be my favorite, you know, my 10 favorite Zappa songs.
Ooh.
And so they play 15, 25 seconds of it. I still say that within the context of editorial or commentary like this, and if you kind of do it without, you know, you're pointing to it.
Well, you can even do the Beatles if you do it right. But there was this one girl who was going through all the Beatles albums and how she had to cut the songs up to get past. It was like, and what they made her cut out and not cut out. She must have had a lot of patience.
Oh, my God. I don't understand them. I don't understand them.
Well, it's all become about a buck. And I understand respecting people's copyright, but they used to pay you to present even a taste of their music, and now
it's true.
They want that 18th of a penny and you not to make any.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And frankly, you know, to me, in some cases, especially if it's observed, if it's, you know, a brief period of time used as commentary or editorial, if it is done in that way, it's promoting somebody's work. At least you're probably not going to run out and do that unless you hear a little piece to get an idea of what it's like. And that is the other mystifying thing on YouTube, is that there's his stuff is everywhere. I mean, it's literally everywhere.
The estate seems to be pretty easygoing because they know those who are going to buy Zappa are going to buy Zappa, even if it's for free somewhere else.
It has to do a little bit with Gail. She was Gail Zappa. She had a commitment to Frank's work that was actually even beyond Frank's work. Frank just said, okay, when I'm dead, get rid of all this stuff, sell everything, and we're done. They said no, and I'm kind of glad they didn't, of course. But she had a kind of an iron fist over that stuff, and it was very difficult for people to either perform the work or get
even
rights
his
to perform
son
it.
At a certain point. I mean, that got a little crazy. And I go back and forth on the Zappa Family Trust. When they auctioned off everything he owned, I still haven't quite swallowed that, like, Moon Unit, who all the children, but Dweezil seem like they just kind of sit at home and watch TV or something.
Yeah, Dweezil, you know, he took it, well, as you know, he took that around. I did see a couple of his performances when he came to Portland, and they were good. I will tell you that. They were good, especially when he used alumni,
right?
Napoleon Brock. But, I'll tell you what happened to me the other day, Brett, and this is going to blow your mind.
Tell me.
I met Napoleon Murphy Brock.
Oh, wow.
And I, by complete accident, because we were going to a show, and I know he was going to be the front man for this orchestra, quote, called the Stinkfoot Orchestra. They come out of the Bay Area. So I wanted to go see them because it was 14 pieces, and they had a great horn section, just awesome. And so, unbeknownst to me, the social media maven,
Regina,
reached out to the band before we got there and said, could we maybe hang out a little bit, talk to you, whatever, you know, love to meet you. And they're fine. They say, yeah, sure, come on. We got a 2.5-hour teardown after this set, so it'd be great. Yeah, come by and say something. So as we're standing there in line, from behind me, I hear Regina say, there's someone here that would like to meet you. And I turn around and I'm looking right into the smiling face of Napoleon Brock. So I chatted for a little bit and I asked him, could we please do an interview? Because this would be a wonderful thing. And he said, yes, he'd be happy to. But why don't you ask the guy whose band it is that I'm fronting and, you know, see how that works out, which, of course, was the right thing to do.
Yeah.
So we talked with Nick Chargan, and we're going to schedule an interview for when they come back to town.
Awesome.
And but what a delightful guy, very self-effacing. And this band, Brett, is awesome. They're playing two tempo. The charts for this 5 or 6 piece horn section, in addition to everybody else, is as tight as I have ever heard it. I mean, the band was tight. Yeah, they were really, really, really on it, and great performances. And of course, Napoleon singing most of the stuff that, you know, he did. This is tough music. So when
when anybody can play it live, and Frank isn't conducting it himself or his son.
Right. Because most of the ones I've seen, I don't know if you've seen any, but the couple that I've seen are like, they're giving it all, but
it's
down tempo, and it's and he knew that. Frank knew that the audience was listening. They weren't just all about the spectacle. They were listening. So, you know, there, like he said that one time, there was some guy that gave Ed Mann some shit because he messed up a vibe intro to Montana or something. And it was like he gave him hell. And so Frank literally stopped the show in the middle of another show, in another song, and said, because of this guy, Ed wants to make good on it. So right now he's going to play the opening to Montana the way it should have been played. And it's like, all right, this is what you do.
Yeah. Good on Frank. No, he sounds like, although he could be a real hard ass.
Yeah.
He loved his musicians.
He did. He did. And he always tried to feature whatever strength they had. That's what he would highlight, you know? So if you had some little thing in your toolbox that you like to do, he would make sure that was front and center. You know, he'd give you all the opportunity in the world to do that. And so, you know, that, but I can't imagine. I mean, those rehearsals had to have been pretty brutal, because they would rehearse for months before they went on.
Yeah.
There,
you know, no, and
took the tour.
Yeah. And most of those people, I think, they would rather have been in a much easier, but they respected Zap and they wanted to do it, obviously, mm-hmm. because it was not an easy ride for anybody. Even somebody who was a great musician, he would push them to be that much better, like Baloo, Steve
right.
Vai.
Yeah, God, these are incredible, incredible talents. And that's interesting, you know, Steve Vai, virtuoso beyond virtuosos. But, you know, imagine being, I don't know how old he was, 17, 18, I don't know how old he was. Imagine presenting Frank with a book of guitar tablature based on all his solos that he transcribed and wrote out.
Yeah, but it got him the gig.
It got him the gig. Stunt guitarist. You know. And thank God it is out there and hasn't been canceled.
I was hoping there was more Vervier stuff to come. When they did Mofo, I was really hoping for one of those for every Verve album.
Oh, wow. Well, now, I'm not going to speak for Joe Travers, but I know he has everything now.
Well,
they have everything, right?
Well, at least they didn't sell that.
Right. No, from what I do know, the only thing that's still not in their possession is the actual master to 200 Motels, the film.
Yeah.
They don't have, because that's MGM, and for some reason they're being very tight sphinctered.
Well, it's like try to do anything from a Broadway show.
Oh,
it's
yeah,
that
right,
same
exactly.
Thing.
And plus the LSO is in it,
and
you got
actors.
Even
the goofy Helza Poppin' that Olsen and Johnson does, which you can see on YouTube.
But right.
In the United States, there will probably never be a commercial release for the same reason that Orgy and Bess, when they show it, it's once.
Oh, man.
And what, like Frank said, when he talked about the Broadway shows that one of his relatives or in-laws worked on.
Right.
You're in it. There's a documentation of it. You can see it once. Once you have seen it once, you can... Can you imagine all the Broadway shows that are documented and rotting?
Right, right.
And even when they go out of copyright, they will not let you see the film.
That's crazy.
Yeah, no kidding.
That's just crazy. That is, and for what, really?
It was, I think, originally to protect it from film industry at destroying Broadway.
Mm. Oh, God. No, Broadway did that all by itself.
No kidding. Especially now, everything is a hip-hop remake of something else. Usually a bad movie. Like, as much as I can appreciate something like Little Shop of Horrors, even, which started it.
Yes, absolutely.
Let's just watch the Corman film, please.
Please. And the music of Fred Katz, who I was just talking to someone about the other day. What great music!
Yeah.
Oh, God. Oh, frankly, I love that movie. I love that movie. I love that texture. I love that black and white. It was done for a dollar and it's a great score. And it's,
I remember the first time I saw it, I didn't know what I was watching. I was flipping around the channels sometime in the 70s. It was on WR. I didn't even know the title of it for a couple of years after. It was just this plant, and this guy. And is that Jack Nicholson? You know?
Do you like monster movies? I really like monster movies.
Let me tell you something. Do you like monster movies? Anybody? I love monster movies. I simply adore monster movies, and the cheaper they are, the better they are. And cheapness, in the case of a monster movie, has nothing to do with the budget of the film, although it helps. But true cheapness is exemplified by visible nylon strings attached to the jaw of a giant spider. I'll tell you a good one that I saw one time. I think the name of the film was It Conquered the World. And do you ever see that one? The monster looks sort of like an inverted ice cream cone with teeth around the bottom. It's like a teepee or a sort of a rounded off pup
monster movie.
Fear.
Oh, cheapness. Yes. Yes, 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 yes. And I mean,
and his taste for junk culture.
And it was funny too, because for some reason that particular movie has eluded. I don't know why. It's in the Corman Library. I don't know why that movie, It Conquered the World, I don't know why it has eluded a proper Blu-ray release. This is very mystifying to me. Let's call up Doc Sleeves right now and find out why that is.
Yeah, there's one film, I think I messaged you once. It's
yes.
It's not the Hammer film Doc Sleeves said it was. And I have yet one of the liminaries
with the red dot,
and it's just a mystery. They must have seen it in Europe sometime in the 80s or early 90s, and I have asked everybody I know who is a horror film person, and we cannot figure out what it is. Maybe it was just a bad dream. It's hard to say.
Was it made in the 70s by any chance, or was it the 80s?
Well, it probably had to have been made after Friday the 13th, because it follows that.
It's a slasher thing?
Yep. But it's these people with a red dot on their head.
Okay.
But, yeah. And they made a film here that's just premiering. It played at during our Fiesta, and I didn't get to see it, but everybody's raving about it. It's called Cop versus Killer. And it's supposed to be, well, I think it's first being officially released this month. We got a sneak preview in May at Fiesta.
Cool.
So I'm keeping it. It's not on file sharing. It's not anywhere. Although that Weebly or whatever, that, God, what's it? It's one of those like, Tubi.
Tubi, yeah.
Has all those B crapo movies. I think they cornered the market on just about everything. The artist Shaman Q. He's another one who's one of these elevated people, but has a taste for the worst in junk culture movies.
Awesome. Well, we definitely could hang.
Oh yeah.
No, there's something charming about that. I love those things. I get a lot of ribbing for some of the stuff in that library upstairs, but I will say that there's joy in that. Like
cheapness.
Cape Canaveral Monsters.
I used to watch that whenever it was on local TV, because it had the arm hanging out of the car window. That was about as like gross a thing as you could see on TV in that era.
Yeah, it was pretty lurid, this thing. And it was black and white. And so, you know, all the blood was chocolate syrup. But they had a lot.
Oh, yeah.
it was a very bloody little thing. You probably had it. And I know we did. We had a thing called... Chillers from Science Fiction. That was the syndicated capsule that all these...
Came out of Chiller Theater, which we had on WPIX for years and years and years.
Yeah.
And Creature Features on what later became Fox Metro Media.
Yeah. Yeah. Shock Theater. You know, every town had their little syndicated button and that. I never tire of that. There are some of these things that come out today in particular. It's like, you're going to watch that probably once.
Yeah, that's it. And okay, it's all right. But although I was surprised, I saw one of Kid Rock's movies recently.
Kid Rock's movies.
And I thought, okay, this is just... And it was actually quite good.
What was it?
I'll have to get the title to you. I don't remember which one. But I really... It was fine. It was a great B movie. His wife stars in them as like, and he's done about five or six, but this is the, I will get you the title.
I had no idea he was even doing that.
Yep. And his music, I can go back, you know, it's like, yeah, him and Nickelback and they're very important to somebody somewhere, just like Fred Durst, I'm sure.
I'm sure. Perfect example. Yes, exactly. Limp Bizkit.
Jesus. Even his own band couldn't stand that music.
No. And you know, I watched, I think it was Woodstock, either Woodstock. Yeah, it was Woodstock 99. You ever seen the documentary of this?
Oh,
this
yeah.
performance? That was horrifying.
Oh yeah.
That was just utterly horrifying. Whole place looked like an inferno. It looked like
I was
Hades,
lucky it
you know?
Didn't become another Altamont. It was that close.
It was that close.
And a lot of people dying, yes.
Yes, exactly. And I mean, just this guy, whether it was done for show or he was just feeling the angst of that audience, I mean, just egging them on, you know.
Well, Fred Durst, that's him. He's just that full of himself.
Yeah, that in the context of the Zappa universe, that never happened.
No.
They did experience fire at Montreux, but that wasn't their fault. Smoke on the water is a real thing, friends.
Yeah.
And it happened. Lost all their equipment and everything. And between that and the... I've only seen little tiny brief pieces of footage mm-hmm. of the Palermo, Italy concert in 1982 where the police and the army got into a scuffle.
Ooh.
So they're fighting each other and tear gas is going off into the crowd and the crowd has nothing to do with this, by the way. They're just there to see Frank and they don't care what's going on. It's happening on the outside of the stadium and unfortunately because of that, all this gas is coming into the
stadium. Oh, God.
And you've got footage of Ray White trying to get through, you know, Green Hotel or whatever he's singing and he's tearing up and they're going through it and they're like wiping their eyes down and everything. And eventually they did get through it. And then they were trapped there because they couldn't get out of the area until the disturbance had cleared.
Yeah.
But I mean,
who's going to protect you when those guys are
no.
trying to kill each other?
It's just this God. It's like, oh, yeah, just another day on the road.
I just consider myself lucky that I got turned on to Zappa so young.
Yes.
I don't know if I mean, the second Zappa album I ever owned, I bought at a flea market. And I only got it because the cover looked like Sgt. Pepper.
Oh, my God.
And
I thought
the album would be like a straight on satire of Sgt. Pepper. I brought it home and I remember putting it on. And the first time I listened to it, I was like, yeah, these are the same people as, that Freak Out album my cousins had. And yeah, that just, I used to bring it to summer camp.
Oh, man.
And I think I got in a little trouble with some other kids' parents for exposing them to.
Oh, my God. Yeah. You know, it's funny because, you know, he says, it's been in numerous documentaries, but it's such a perfect parody of the Sgt. Pepper's cover. They did run it by the Beatles. They had no problem, but somebody else did.
Yeah, Capitol Records or EMI.
Yeah, right.
Or, yep.
Yeah, somebody else up there who doesn't know shit from Shinola apparently had some issue, so they couldn't do it.
Well, they didn't get crushed as bad as Negative Land did. And
oh,
and you two revision wise, we didn't have a problem with it. It was that guy over there. Although I can understand, I mean, you two in big letters and Negative Land on in little letters.
Yeah,
it was.
Come on, they were poking the beast. They knew.
Well, yeah,
but I've been listening to
those Over the Edges. Those are just
they are so good.
And there's more of those in Gene Shepherd's shows, and they're like
oh, I know.
4 hours no, long.
They're like a day of experience. There's a documentary too on. KPFA and specifically him,
Don Joyce,
it's called How Not to Do Radio or something like that. Yeah, that was utterly fascinating.
And I've talked to Weebly a few times on Facebook and I keep saying I want to be the next new member of Negative Land, which he thinks is hilarious. And Weatherman was a friend on Facebook while he was on Facebook, but It was too much for him and he had to leave Facebook.
I don't blame him.
Well, he's not exactly. He is that obsessive and obsessively clean and.
Yeah, not.
Very serious about his stuff.
Yeah,
and
sure.
He's brilliant. He invented that booper thing. before anybody was making little handheld electronic gizmos.
Oh, God. That was him? Okay. Yep. Didn't know that. Oh, no, that's, I still, it's hard for me to wrap my head around. I would love to, even though there is footage of it, it's not like sitting in Joyce's room watching him do that.
Oh, yeah.
With like seven cart machines or turntables and reel to reel.
Yeah, he was doing it before there was digital and you could just real quick, like I can do cut ups now. When I first started doing audio collage, you had to get a boombox with two dual tape decks, and the pause button had to be tight, which most of them have that soft touch. And I used to go to stores all over New York City to find one, and I would be testing them. They'd be looking at me like I was nuts.
Nice. Well, but you got to. Otherwise, you get the click and the click and all that and crap in there. Getting back to our man of the hour here.
For the equipment he had at the time, what he could do. I mean, those Verve albums were done
on reel-to-reel tape. Cutting multi-tracks, which is, you know, what? Yes, absolutely. Cutting multi-tracks. No. At a certain point in time, I was working in that format for a while, and yeah, you do it because you have to sometimes.
Radio, having to use the cutting block, it was like... Oh.
Yeah, I don't regret those days. I appreciate having them and having years of that experience, but I don't miss that for 1 minute.
Oh, no.
Thank you and goodbye.
No, that was like nerve-wracking.
Crazy.
Because once you cut it wrong,
you're done.
That was the end.
You're done. Yeah. And you can go find an S. Go find a T, you know.
Oh. Yeah.
No. No, thank you. I believe I'll pass up. But you just think of him sitting there. And I mean, you've seen those docs with him. He would do the same thing. And I guess that was a thing with folks who used, who actually wrote music out. He would do a lot of that cut and paste with actual music graph,
right.
The staffs, you know, and you cut pieces out. You see him all the time doing that, sitting there all sweaty with no shirt on and just kind of, and it's like, I can't imagine that. But, you know. You're driven, and that's...
Oh, he's definitely... music... Was there ever a time where he just, like, took a break from music ever?
No, I don't think so. I think maybe he knew.
Yeah. Well, Hot Rats only happened because he got, thrown off that stage.
Yes, exactly.
And he couldn't go out on tour, and he gathered the boys and wrote the stuff, and... He doesn't really even play a lot on that.
No, and let's see, which album was it? It was, well, there's two instances of this. The Lumpy Gravy thing, he licensed himself out.
Right.
Because it was a different record label, so he couldn't play on it. So he's on it by, you know, proxy. But yeah, like it was either, is it Chunga's Revenge?
It might be.
There's pictures of him in a wheelchair. He's playing, but he's still in a wheelchair. He's got his foot up and all that. And this album, this Waka.
Joe Waka. Oh, no.
Yeah. It's Chunga's Waka's Jawaka, whatever it is. It's all that. All those. Because all that stuff is kind of happening simultaneously. But Waka Jawaka and Grand Wazoo. Yeah.
Those I had to go back because when they came out, they were just too much for my little brain.
They're a hefty dose. They've grown to become some of my favorites. There's some very angry material on Us and Them. You're hearing it right now, folks. These guitar solos right here. Obviously, it was record company stuff.
Yeah.
that was coming up. That is just, I mean, I get it. I totally get it. You're dealing with probably some of the worst people in the industry. I can't imagine. Cocaine decisions. That's a factual thing. It is exactly what happened during that time and how it affected not only his life, but the lives of many artists.
Oh, no. Anybody who wasn't capitulating and just doing what the corporate masters demanded to provide a commercial package for the kids.
Yeah, for the kids. Yes, what did he used to call it? A something mover unit, a friendly something.
Yeah, like, friendly yeah, unit mover.
Or something. Yeah. Because, I wasn't going to do that. Because anytime you're talking about the prime rate poodle, you're going to get in trouble. Oh, God. I love that. I'm glad he published that. There was an article he attempted to submit to Newsweek. And, of course, they took one look at his article and said, I'm sorry, you're just a little too idiosyncratic for us, Mr. Zappa, so I'm afraid we're going to have to decline. But if you read that article, he's got it somewhere. It's on his been archived somewhere. Mm-hmm. It's brilliant. And yes, it is very idiosyncratic, but it's also very funny, very insightful, and really kind of distills down the whole political entertainment complex as it is. I mean, and we're living it right now.
Oh, yeah. No, it's Frank Zappa versus the Mothers of Prevention.
Yes, wonderful.
Is another, like, he was a little perturbed at the time.
Rightly so. That was a time where record labeling was going to be, the PMRC were all over the, trying to get labeling, but tax it. You know, that was the weird thing.
Oh, yeah. Well, it's also, we need a little, those, our bank accounts offshore in Costa Rica need some more gravy.
Yeah, exactly. Because the interest rate is so good there. man.
Oh, one day that somebody, a good hacker, is just going to make all that money disappear into somewhere in Russia.
Yes, exactly. Maybe they already have. Okay. You never know. Yeah, but they got their little label.
Yeah, how
thing.
Do you complain when all your Costa Rica money suddenly you get a bank statement and it says $12.75?
Who do you complain to? The FCC? Yeah. The FTC?
The FTC, yeah. And, the number of live shows on Spotify is just, I'm trying to scroll down to get to his studio albums because that's how they're presented. It's like the title and then all the tracks and then another, mm-hmm. and it's just scroll, 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 scroll. 5 minutes later, scroll, scroll, scroll. And then finally you get a few, and then there's some more live. It's just vast.
So are the live albums like from like the bootleg period, or
they're getting them through the Zappa Family Trust because they're legit. Okay. But I don't think there are that many in actual release. I think a lot of these are virtual albums that they've cleaned up the tapes and they realize it's going to be another 30 years before they can really release them. And they'll take that eighth of a cent to play or whatever they get. God. And somebody actually has taken an interest in making his music available, or like would be nothing on YouTube.
No, it's true. A couple of the people who have, there's a guy named, there's a channel called the Aaron Channel and another one called BRT Tag or Brit Tag or whatever. Those are people who are actually connected to them in some way. So they have kind of carte blanche. But still, it's there. And frankly, if they don't do this, and if people like Nick and folks like that aren't allowed to present this material, it's like everything else. It'll just evaporate. So, shows like we're doing right now, things like this, something to keep the message alive. And no, it's not for everybody. But like Frank said, he made music for the people who liked it.
Yeah.
And so there's a lot more of them than are probably aware. Some of them are being born right now.
he hasn't faded. I mean, a lot of these artists, Elvis, I think his day has finally come where he's really going to do that big fade. The people who are the diehard fans are.
Oh, yeah, of course.
Like the Bing Crosby fans. And somebody like Jackie Gleason, forget it now. Yeah. He's so politically to the moon, Alice, and that angry cis male. He's finished.
Yep, it's true. Yeah, a lot of that is just.
And I tried to turn some younger people on to Jackie. He scared them. It was
shouting,
funny at
yelling,
all.
Shouting. Yeah.
No, you can't raise your voice like that anymore. Even if you're angry, you have to. Yes, you know you've upset me very much, Alice. And I think we need to have a little talk.
One of these days. Okay. Yeah, it's not going to work. Yeah, it's a thing of its time. Some of it was just, you know.
And the old time radio that I used to include in my shows.
Yeah.
I don't, a lot of it, I no longer feel comfortable presenting. I'm Jack Benny, as great as Rochester is.
I
don't even know how to put it, but young people, they hear that and it's like horrible.
Well, please, for me, don't drop any of the Bob and Ray, because
I skipped some them doing some Chinese voices. And Gene Shepherd, when he would do his friend who ran the Chinese restaurant.
Yes.
I will know, because it's just off-putting to the nth degree. And other stuff, Bob and Ray, there's one thing on archive.org that just has everything in one place. It's like the best of the best of the complete Bob and Ray. And it has all those other compilations that are also on archive, plus a bunch of stuff that I've never heard.
And that I've heard this. Yeah, you played a couple. One Vic and Say that was probably the cleanest
version of that I've ever heard. He's dying. He's this old radio collector. He's been releasing his stuff for free, pay what you will. But these people on Facebook are busting his balls because he'll only do FLAX. He should do MP3s.
No. That's great to keep the quality up. Yeah.
They annoyed him so much, he's no longer posting them on Facebook.
Is he available somewhere?
You can friend him. And if you look up Ted Davenport online, he has this really rinky-tink site. But if you contact him, he'll start sending you the links. I mean, I think those several Vic and Sades that are out of circulation but are recorded and only in collector hands, he quietly included in that. Because I have heard one or two going through it that I'm pretty sure I never heard before.
That one in particular was like,
white. But even the ones that aren't, they're much better than the versions on archive.org or anywhere else.
Good. Yeah, because, you know, people try to help them and they run them through noise reduction and all that, and it just makes them sound like crap. And
well, the nice thing is, once some AI is in the hands of the consumer, we're going to be able to clean up all those quiet pleases that you can't hear and all those and probably take all those Vic and Sage scripts.
Yes.
And feed it through the AI and we'll have all those shows.
Yeah. Yeah.
Not recreations, but voices that sound remarkably like Bill Idelson.
Yes. And they'll do it. They'll
Bernadette
do it.
Bernadette Flynn and Clarence Hartzell.
I haven't sprung it yet in the show, but I'm going to in the next month or two. But I've been doing some deep dive into 11labs.io, and these guys are pretty slick. And I see what, you know, again, we're being used as the R&D for this company, as we are for all of those companies. But I'm impressed by what they do from the range of expressiveness. The expressiveness is getting better and better daily.
Oh, yeah.
It's, you know, it's like, wow. And, you know, you don't have quite the control you do when you're a text-based, you know, video or text-based art kind of thing.
Yep.
It's still kind of trying to find the clever way of typing something so that the...
But what Peter Bernard, who does the Dogman stories, he's been on the channel on and off.
Yeah.
I had been complaining that I have to run my air conditioner because it's just so hot here, and trying to get that out in post-production is like, it takes half the tone out of your voice.
Right.
Adobe now has an online free noise reduction that's AI.
Yes.
And it takes that air conditioner out like that. And what he said was, because it's AI, if you blah, 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 and hum a song like that, It will make a song out of it because the AI detects that it's a song, and he says that I should try doing that on some of my shows. So that will be coming up.
Yes, that would be fun.
And that Adobe's would be fun. Doing something free after all these years of charging way too much for a software that, you know, I still use Photoshop 7, and there's nothing I feel I'm lacking that I need to get Creative Studio or subscribe at $80 a month.
Ridiculous. They're usurious. I was using one of their things today. Check it out too. It's called Adobe Express, and it's kind of taking little bits of all of their stuff. It's free.
Yep.
That does have an AI component that is rather impressive. I wasn't using it for that. I was just using it to quickly create this little montage thing that I needed to do. And it took about 2 seconds. it's pretty damn good.
Once these things they're doing that sound like new Beatles songs. I mean, 2 years ago, it sounded like somebody was playing the Beatles in the next room. And yes, oh, is that new Beatles? Now it's like,
wow.
And Paul is somewhat in on it. I mean, he's only using it to pull stuff out of tapes. But if he lives another 5 years, it could get interesting.
Yeah, that's very interesting.
Because once he's dead, they're going to lock that whole thing down tight as a drum.
Yeah, literally.
Oh, yeah. I'm surprised they wound up like on Apple Music and Spotify.
Well, the Zappa part of the world almost had that for a while. It was
getting close because, that at a certain point, the family trust understandably was trying to crack down on bootlegs.
Right.
And
Frank, back in the day when that was happening, he took the right approach. You're not going to stop them. So why don't you release them?
And clean them up nicer and...
Yeah, go ahead and do it. And so, those things are prized beyond belief now. I think that's the best way to deal with a lot of this stuff is sometimes meet it head on and don't, you're not going to stop it.
So. Oh yeah. Not it's like a lot of things. Once the horse is out of the barn, no matter what you do, the horse is out of the barn now.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, you're definitely out of the barn very much and down the way and clearing it. Well, let me make a proposition to you.
Okie dokie.
Because I'm jazzed. I love what's happening here. So what say we plan to, it will take little bites. Why don't we plan to do that? Why don't we plan to take a deep dive into these, into this catalog?
All right. So let's at some time in the next, when we both have time, let's look at, say, Freak Out and Absolutely Free, the first two albums.
Absolutely. Yes. Let's do that.
And see what happens, because I'm game, and if we get even one person who has not fallen into the conceptual continuity to
it's a win.
Oh yeah.
It's a win. Another convert.
Yeah, because and the funny thing about all those Beatles things we did, I could not find one person to send in a segment and tell me how much they hated the Beatles, how stupid they were, how they're immature. Not one person. And I like kept putting it out. You don't have to like them. I want to hear what you didn't like,
Nobody.
I thought Doc Sleaze would do it, because I remember years ago, we did a smaller thing on the Beatles and they just weren't that big a deal to him.
Right. To him,
but he's just such a great and eccentric character. He really
is just the best.
I wish he was a little more talkative on the exit ramps, because we're all so big and bombastic, I think.
He's very polite that way. I love his shows.
I listen to them over and over. I try to find all the movies he mentions in various realms of obtaining, although now I think they're all on Tubi.
There probably are. Yeah, I'm sure. That has ads too, right? Isn't there ads?
Yeah, but those bad movies, I don't think they can get anybody to pay to put ads on them. So it might be one ad. It isn't like watching something that's modern. Yeah, then they'll really bury you in ads. but
yeah,
it's very selective what they stick and how many ads they stick on things, it appears.
Yeah, well, good. I'll check them out, because sometimes you just want, you know.
Just absolute, just, yeah.
Got to have it.
Like watching Gigantor, which is the being schlock up at the Ed Wood of cartoons.
Yes, it really is. Never thought of it that way, but yes, it is. Oh, man. Yeah, Astro Boy still kind of fave for me. I still kind of.
Oh, yeah.
Still have a little soft spot for Astro Boy.
Oh, yeah. No, I remember watching this. One of the few things I remember watching from a kid, and then they disappeared for years. But mm-hmm. Thank God when VHS came back, people started. That was like a real renaissance in and of itself.
Oh, man. Yeah.
And the company that Chad used to work for, Funimation, at the time,
yes,
they were Jeez. Like the renaissance when
yes,
you could only get the stuff like trading. I remember trading VHS tapes with people and it was like horrible copies with bad subtitles and everything yeah. looked like it was made out of nylon.
Back in the yeah. day, dubs.
Yep.
Yeah, you'd still pay a premium.
Oh, yeah, and happily.
Yes, and happily, because where else would you see it? You wouldn't, you know, that's part of the problem. So this has been delightful.
No,
and
this is a great pleasure.
If you want to talk about pleasure, that was just fabulous. So many thanks to Marc Rose. So many thanks to you. And as you heard, and as we have discussed off mic, there's going to be more. There's going to be more Frank Zappa here with Marc Rose and your appreciator. And until the next time we all gather and listen together, so to speak, set the controls for the heart of the fun.